Good morning, my brothers and sisters in Christ. This is a day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Welcome to the third Sunday of our audio church service. I pray that today's service will be a blessing to all of us. Please have your Bible, prayer book, hymn book, and writing material ready, along with a meditative heart, to hear God speak to us through prayer, song, Bible readings, and today's message. Let us give Him thanks and praise for this week that He has given to us and for another day on His earth. Have a blessed day. A blessed good morning and welcome to all Methodists and friends of Methodism as we worship together this morning, the fifth Lord's Day in Lent. This is the day which the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Let me hear the worshipers! Where's all of my praises? Put your hands together because all the praise belongs to God. Here we go. It's to our God. Every word of worship. With one accord. Every praise. Every praise. It's to our God. Come on, everybody. Sing hallelujah. To our God. Glory, hallelujah. It's to our God. Come on, say every praise. Say every praise. It's to our God. Y'all know how we do it. Take it up. Every praise. It's to our God. Every word of worship. With one accord. Come on, say every praise. Every praise. It's to our God. I want everybody all over the world to sing hallelujah to our God. Glory, hallelujah. It's to our God. Every praise. Every praise. It's to our God. Let's take it up one more time. Every praise. Come on, everybody. Every word of worship. With one accord. Every praise. Every praise is to our God. I don't care how you're feeling right now. Sing hallelujah to our God. Glory, hallelujah. Every praise. Every praise is to our God. Hey, this is what I love.
Please join me in the call to worship as printed on page 68 of the Methodist prayer book. Our help is in the name of the Lord our God, who made heaven and earth. Our salvation is in the Lord Jesus Christ, who died for our sins and rose for our justification. Our confidence is in the Holy Spirit, who enables us to become God's children. The Lord reigns. Let the earth rejoice. Our God reigns. We shall be glad and wait for his word. Our opening hymn is number 49 in the Voices in Praise, or number 92 in the Methodist hymn book. Jesus, the name high over all.
Let us pray. Almighty God, creator of the universe, we come to you this morning in this act of worship in all humility. Even though we are in our separate homes and unable to assemble in one place, nonetheless, we are the body of Christ, united in love and adoration. At this time, we have been quarantined in one place and have to stay away from each other physically. We can still reach out and support each other by various means of communication, and we are grateful for this. In spite of it all, we are surrounded by your awesome creation, and we know how fortunate we are to live on this beautiful island. We thank you, Lord, for the sunshine, rain, and the clean air, the fertile soil and the many crops that we grow with which we can feed ourselves. Now that our country is isolated from the rest of the world. This morning, Lord, we especially want to thank you for your living word, which strengthens and empowers us. Thank you for enabling us to rise out of discouragement, anxiety, and uncertainty in the sure knowledge that you are beside us every step of the way. As we go through this time of testing, may our minds be stayed on you, Lord, and grant us that peace and understanding that only you can give. Enable us to dwell in safety, protecting us from all harm and danger, including the dreaded virus. May your angels take charge over us to guide us in all our ways. This morning, Lord, we ask for a fresh infilling of the Holy Spirit working in us to reveal the fruits of the Spirit and order in our steps so we can dwell under your protecting arms. We thank you also for all the blessings of life, godly parents, family and friends, and our community of faith. Enable us, Lord, to be ever conscious of your saving grace, which enables us to walk in your ways and grow in faithfulness and love. May this act of worship draw us closer to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
The call to reconciliation. We are fearful in these moments and so lose faith. We wonder what tomorrow will bring and so lose our trust in God. We see and hear and share in hurtful deeds and angry words and so lose our humanity. So let us wait for God's mercy and grace as we come with our prayers for forgiveness, saying, let us now in unison pray for forgiveness. We are scared, God of our lives, with uncertainty with the coronavirus. Our days are spent in isolation. Even when we are with family, we wonder if you are with us or whether you are taking your sweet time to come into our emptiness. We worry about being safe or having enough or what will become of us tomorrow. Yet, the good news is that you are indeed with us, God of our days. Yet, the good news is that you have come, Jesus, our brother, to weep with us and over us, to comfort us and to call us to live in faith. Yet, the good news is that you cradle us in your peace, Spirit of gentleness, rocking us to sleep on troubled nights, opening our eyes to the grace of each morning, filling us with the love and hope we can share with everyone around us. Yet, the good news is still good news, and so may we trust, believe, hope, and live as your people. Amen. Assurance of pardon. Can our hope live? Put your hope in God, dear friends, for God offers us that love which never fades, that life which never ends. Together, we wait for God, and God does not fail us. God's hope, God's love, and God's grace are forever. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let us now sing hymn number 104 in the Voices in Praise, or 183 in the Methodist hymn book, In the Cross of Christ I Glory.
And good morning to all worshiping with us this morning. This is our third service via social media, and we wish each and everyone a pleasant and wonderful day. We pray that each of us are following our good hygiene practices, and we are adhering to our limited restriction that has been passed by the government on last Wednesday. It is a privilege and a joy to be here worshiping with you, and we pray that God would continue to give each and every one of us the strength, the guidance, the fortitude, and all that is needed as we go through this period of COVID-19. We wish everyone who's celebrating birthdays, anniversary, we wish them a happy, happy celebration. And we wish all who are celebrating the gift of life all the best. I would now read to you a message from our superintendent minister. And it reads, "Dear brothers and sisters, let me express sincere gratitude to each of you for your cooperation and understanding as we continue to navigate this difficult season of social distancing, occasioned by the risk posed by the current threat of the COVID-19. The latest address by Prime Minister Dr. the Right Honorable Keith Mitchell, aired on Wednesday, March 25, 2020, signals a new phase in this process as he has called upon Governor General to activate a limited state of emergency in Grenada, Carico, and Petite Martinique. As a result, all members are asked to note the following changes that will affect the Methodist Church Grenada Circuit immediately. The circuit office will be closed and the secretary will work from home. You will be able to contact her on the via email grenadamethodist@gmail.com or telephone number 403-0907. I repeat, grenadamethodist@gmail.com or telephone number 403-0907. We will continue to use the various social media platform to air services each Sunday. We are also planning to administer the sacrament of the Lord's Supper via social media on April 5th and 12th respectively. We will be therefore encouraging all members to prepare their own elements in readiness for this spiritual experience. We are also appealing to our members who are able to continue to support the work of the church with your tithes and offering as we endeavor to fulfill our financial obligations during this period. To this end, I am appealing to the congregational stewards to put the necessary processes in place that this can be facilitated. In the event that members are unable to contact the congregational stewards or vice versa, payment of tithes and offering can be paid directly into the circuit account 104469 at Republic Bank. A receipt should be obtained as proof of payment, after which the stewards are also encouraged to acquire duplicate receipt books in order to record and furnish receipts to persons making cash offerings. Class leaders are encouraged to make an effort to secure a list of their class members and, where possible, give them a call to offer prayers and spiritual support in this time of anxiety. Facilitators of Bible study classes are also asked to use social media where possible to create opportunity for the study to continue. Holy Week service will be online. A plan will be sent out. The circuit extends condolence to the family of Rev. Hughes Ford, who was residing in the North Trinidad circuit. The Thanksgiving service of his life took place yesterday at the Tranquility Methodist Church, Trinidad. May his soul rest in peace. Let's keep his family in our prayers. Finally, let me take this opportunity to assure each member of our church that you are in the heart and prayer of the circuit staff in this time of uncertainty. We pray that as we traverse the difficult season together, we will continue to trust the God who promises never to leave us nor forsake us. May the God of peace keep you, keep your hearts and mind in the knowledge and love of God. Superintendent, yours sincerely, Reverend Prescott, Superintendent. Let us continue to lift each other up in our prayers and try to be helpful with each other and to continue to love each other as God continues to love us and continue to guide us in this time. As it said, he will never leave us nor forsake us. So let us put our trust in him, knowing that he is willing and he is able to take care of our needs. Let us practice good hygiene, because God has given us the knowledge and the ability to do that is necessary. So let us practice our good hygiene and our social distancing as we go through this period of uncertainty. And for those of us who are essential worker, let us by all means as possible try to be safe. And for those who are home, find something to do and don't sit and dwell on this period. May God continue to bless us all, and we thank Brother Brian who has been working hard to compile all the information that is being sent to him and to prepare this social broadcast. May God just continue to bless us. Thank you. An additional notice for persons who are unable to deposit their tithes and offering via our circuit account 104469, you are asked to keep it in a special place, probably a box or something, until we meet again where we would be able to collect it. And for St. George's, I will just give you our the congregational steward's telephone number so you could call to make arrangements. Donna Lucen, 417-6780. 417-6780. Pamela Ed, 407-5557. 407-5557. Brother Roy O'Neill, 409-2146. 409-2146. And Susan Abraham, 404-0860. 404-0860. And we can all be reached via WhatsApp also. Thank you.
We bring the sound.
We worship God with our entire being, and so we offer to God our tithes and offering as part of our sincere worship to Him. Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for all your marvelous gifts to us. As a token of our appreciation and worship to you, we offer our gift of money. Take and bless it, so that it may be used for the furtherance of your kingdom here on earth. This we pray in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We now sing hymn number 159 in the Voices in Praise, or hymn number 300 in the Methodist hymn book, Breathe on Me, Breath of God. We now go into the ministry of the word. Please listen to the colic for today. Gracious Father, you gave up your Son out of love for the world. Lead us to ponder the mysteries of his passion, that we may know eternal peace through the shedding of our Savior's blood. Jesus Christ, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The scripture reading is taken from Ezekiel chapter 37, verses 1 to 14, the Valley of Dry Bones. The hand of the Lord came upon me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me down in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me all around them. They were very dry. He said to me, "Mortal, can these bones live?" I answered, "O Lord God, you know." Then he said to me, "Prophesy to these bones and say to them, O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God to these bones, I will cause breath to enter you, and you shall live. I will lay sinews on you, and I will cause flesh to come upon you, and cover you with skin, and put breath in you, and you shall live. And you shall know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I had been commanded. And as I prophesied, suddenly there was a noise, a rattling, and the bones came together, bone to its bone. I looked, and there were sinews on them, and flesh had come upon them, and skin had covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, prophesy to the breath, prophesy mortal, and say to the breath, thus says the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe upon these slain, that they may live. I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they lived and stood on their feet, a vast multitude. Then he said to me, mortal, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They say, our bones are dried up and our hope is lost. We are cut off completely. Therefore, prophesy and say to them, thus says the Lord God, I am going to open your graves and bring you up from your graves. O my people, I will bring you back to land of Israel, and you shall know that I am the Lord when I open your graves and bring you up from the graves, from your graves. O my people, I will put spirit within you, and you shall live, and I will place you on your own soil. Then you shall know that I, the Lord, have spoken and will act, says the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
The scripture reading is taken from Psalm 130. Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my supplications. If you, O Lord, should mark iniquities, Lord, who could stand? But there is forgiveness with you, so that you may be revered. I wait for the Lord, my soul waits, and in his word I hope. My soul waits for the Lord more than those who watch for the morning, more than those who watch for the morning. O Israel, hope is in the Lord. For with the Lord there is steadfast love, and with him is great power to redeem. It is he who will redeem Israel from all its iniquities. This is the word of the Lord.
The epistle reading is taken from Ephesians chapter 6, reading from verses 1 to 20. Ephesians 6, verses 1 to 20. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother. This is the first commandment with a promise, so that it may be well with you and you may live long on the earth. And fathers, do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. Slaves, obey your earthly masters with fear and trembling, in singleness of heart, as you obey Christ, not only while being watched and in order to please them, but of slaves of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart. Render service with enthusiasm as to the Lord, and not to men and women, knowing that whatever we do, we will receive the same again from the Lord, whether we are slaves or free. And masters, do the same to them. Stop threatening them, for you know that both of you have the same master in heaven, and with him there is no partiality. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his power. Put on the whole armor of God, so that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For our struggle is not against the enemies of blood and flesh, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers of this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, so that you may be able to withstand on that evil day, and having done everything, to stand firm. Stand therefore and fasten the belt of truth around your waist, and put on the breastplate of righteousness. As shoes for your feet, put on whatever will make you ready to proclaim the gospel of peace. With all of these, take the shield of faith, with which you will be able to quench all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Pray in the Spirit at all times, in every prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert and always persevere in supplication for all the saints. Pray also for me, so that when I speak, a message may be given to me to make known with boldness the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it boldly, as I must speak. My brothers and sisters, this is the word of the Lord.
Blessed morning, my brothers and sisters in Christ. The gospel for today comes to us from John 3:16 to 21, and it reads, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Those who believe in him are not condemned, but those who do not believe are condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of the only Son of God. And this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world, and people love darkness rather than the light, because their deeds were evil. For all who do evil hate the light and do not come to the light, so that the deeds may not be exposed. But those who do what is true come to the light, so that it may be clearly seen that the deeds have been done in God. This is the gospel according to Christ."
I will now invite Reverend Prescott to deliver his message. And I pray that God would continue to guide him as, together with the circuit staff, he lead the circuit during this time. It is also my prayer that we would all open our hearts, our mind, and our soul to receive his word and to be guided by what the Lord has placed on his heart. Reverend Prescott.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. I greet you all in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. It is my joy and pleasure once again to be with you another Sunday morning as we meet via this medium. This morning I would like to share with you from John chapter 3, reading verse 17. "God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him." Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we give you thanks for the power of your word in our lives. When everything fails, gracious God, your word continues to sustain and keep us. In your word, O God, you said heaven and earth will pass away, but your word will remain forever. So speak the word of life to us, loving God, and may your word fill us with hope and meaning and purpose. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Recently, I was listening to a popular televangelist as he expounded what he called the reason for the coronavirus. According to this preacher, God had sent the coronavirus as a means of condemning a present world order that worships money. In that preacher's mind, God is using this pandemic as a rod of correction against a world that have given itself to the worshiping of a deity other than the true and living God. Unfortunately, this is a popular view of many religious pundits, many of whom view God as some bully of sorts, standing over the world, waiting to pounce on every human transgression. But the problem with such a view is that it presents us with the image of a God who is vengeful, angry, and to be avoided. Fortunately, this is not the picture of God Jesus paints in John's Gospel, chapter 3, verse 17. He says, God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Indeed, God's purpose for the world is not condemnation, but rather reconciliation. Indeed, friends, I find this to be a rather reassuring message for all God's people during this time of crisis in which we find ourselves. It reminds us that in the midst of our pain and suffering, God has not abandoned us, but is at present working through our challenges to bring healing and wholeness to our world. This is John's message for us as we continue to try to make sense of our lives and our world in this very dark part of our experience. But of course, in order for us to fully understand the picture John is trying to paint here for us, we have to read the verses within its own context. We have to remember that this passage forms part of a larger context in John chapter 3, where Jesus is encountering a man called Nicodemus. In this passage, Jesus is sharing conversation with the man in question, and he is talking to him about the process by which one enters the realm of God. Nicodemus, we learn, comes to Jesus under the cover of night. And he comes not only because of fear of ostracism from his peers, but because he has learned about the signs of Jesus and wants to hear from the horse's mouth the true identity and purpose of this miracle worker. Of course, Jesus does not give him a direct answer, but he uses the opportunity to point out to Nicodemus about the way that leads into God's realm. Of course, we know that Nicodemus was a leader of the Jews and a Pharisee at that, one who was steeped in the tradition that strict observance to the law was the primary vehicle by which one gains acceptance from God. But Jesus refutes such a thinking. He indicates that entrance into the kingdom of God is not by any human endeavor, but rather a gift of love accessed by one's response to Jesus only. In other words, God's acceptance is not based on one's worthiness, but rather on one's response to Jesus. So Nicodemus here is faced with a decision, either to let go of his long-held beliefs or to enter and to embrace this new gift that Jesus is offering. Of course, we are not sure if he does, but we do get a clear sense that here Jesus is casting for Nicodemus and each of us a picture of a God who relates to humankind not on the basis of vengeance and punishment, but on one of love and grace. Indeed, God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that through him the world might be saved. This morning, brothers and sisters, I want to invite us to explore the meaning and implication of these words for us at this very time and period. Firstly, John tells us that Jesus Christ did not come into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Friends, the emergence of the coronavirus have raised a question that is as old as humankind. That is, what is the meaning and purpose of suffering in our world? Does disaster happen because of God's judgment? Is God using suffering as a means of identifying who is good and who is evil? I am not sure about that. But what I do know is that every time there is a major disaster in our world, these questions do emerge from time to time. I remember some years ago, for example, amidst a major flooding in a particular country, people within certain religious circles were claiming that God was punishing the people because of their practices. But as I said in my sermon a couple weeks ago, one of the reasons why this view is not so widely embraced today is because the coronavirus has hit everyone. You see, friends, it is human nature to point fingers at others. And what we are really doing when we identify faults is that we are touting our own worthiness. We are claiming that because we have been spared from disaster, we are better than those who haven't. In other words, we are good because God has spared us, and others are bad because God did not spare them. In this text, this is not the way that Jesus reads it. In Jesus' mind, God relates to us on the basis of love rather than vengeance. On the basis of grace rather than merit. In other words, all are sinners. And none of us can do anything to bridge that gap between us and God. Our acceptance is based on what God does for us, not on what we can do for God. In other words, there is nothing that we can do to merit God's acceptance. None of us can and will ever do enough to deserve God's grace. Rather, his acceptance is offered to us as a gift that is free. Paul makes this very clear in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8, when he writes, "For by grace you are saved, and it is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not the result of works, so no one might boast." Friends, one of the reasons why many people are reluctant to come to church is because too often we paint a picture of a condemning God. Indeed, one of the reasons why people avoid a church is the fact that the church is always condemning them and pointing out the sins, flaws, and imperfections of this world. But Jesus offers a different approach. Time and time again, he holds up a picture for us of God's love. And throughout his life and ministry, that is what he practiced. He was known as the sinner's friend and one who welcomed outcasts. For example, in John chapter 8, John tells us a story of a woman who was caught in adultery. And the scribes and the Pharisees of Jesus' day brought this woman to Jesus in order for him to pronounce the guilty verdict. As they pressed Jesus for a response, John tells us that Jesus stooped down on the ground and began to write. After he had finished, he looked up at the men and said, Let him who is without sin cast the first stone. After they departed, Jesus addressed the woman, saying, Woman, where are your accusers? Is there no one to condemn you? And then he said to her, Neither do I condemn you. You see, friends, when we remember that all without exception have fallen short of God's grace and love and standards, then we will look at others differently. The psalmist reminds us where we all sit with God when he writes, If thou should mark iniquity, Lord, who shall stand? You see, brothers and sisters, like the religious leaders in this text, we are often so quick to think the worst of others, to condemn and to put them down. So often we do that, and so much so that we miss the opportunity to offer compassion. So often we can become so set in the idea that our rules are more important than people, that ethics are more valuable than individual lives, that religious laws are more important than a person's life, that we forget to do what we can to help others. Here, the teachers of the law knew the law, and they were willing to apply the full letter of it, even to the demise of the woman. But not so with Jesus. For him, justice was always tempered with mercy. He did it so for so many people, and he is always willing to do it for each of us. That is why the Apostle Paul was able to say, He is at the right hand of God, interceding for us. And therefore, even as the world continues to struggle to come to terms with all the suffering and sickness and death that surrounds us, even amidst all the threats that the coronavirus is posing to our world, God's people can still bring hope to our world, reminding people that Jesus is at the right hand of God interceding for the world, not condemning them. That Jesus is praying for the world and offering healing to the world, not condemning them. That is why, brothers and sisters, all of us can declare, like our Methodist hymn writer when he writes in our famous Methodist hymn 371, No condemnation, now I dread. Jesus and all in him is mine. Alive in him, my living head, and clothed in righteousness divine. Yes, friends, the good news for us is that Jesus did not come to condemn us, but he came to save. He came to heal, and he came to touch us with his hand of grace. Secondly, friends, John tells us that Jesus came into the world in order that the world through him might be saved. Now, I find this to be quite interesting, a very interesting thought when one considers the way that John uses the word world in his gospel. Throughout John, we get a sense that there is a clear distinction between those who belong to the world and those who belong to Christ. In chapter 7, verse 17 and 15, for example, he says that the world hates Jesus. And in chapter 14, verse 17, he says that the world is unable to receive the Spirit of truth. On another occasion, he also says, or states that the world does not know the Father. In John 17, he goes on to explain that the disciples has been taken out of the world in order for them to belong to Christ. And so even though they are continuing to live in the world, they no longer share the character of the world because they now belong to Christ by the virtue of receiving his word. So what I'm trying to say, brothers and sisters, is that in John's gospel, The world is often characterized as sinful, rebellious, and alienated from God. In other words, the world represents fallen humanity, living in opposition to the will of God. People who are on the other side of God, so to speak. Yet, friends, it is this same world that Jesus loves. Even the world is fallen and it is opposed to God's will. It is into this world that God sends Jesus. It is this world that Jesus gives his life for. And it is this world that Jesus came to save. I like the way Paul puts it in Ephesians 2, verse 1 to 5. I will paraphrase it for you. It says, "You were dead in your trespasses and sins, following the ruler of the power of the air. And we were by nature children of wrath. But God, who is rich in mercy, out of the great love with which he loved us, when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ." Paul goes on to say in Romans chapter 5, verse 8 and 9, "But God proved his love for us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." Yes, brothers and sisters, Jesus came not to condemn the world, but to save the world. The word "save" that John uses here is the Greek word sozo, which could also be translated to heal. So the purpose of Jesus is not to condemn the world, but to heal and to save the world. And so, my question for us this morning is, what does it mean for us that Jesus come to save the world? What is John trying to say to us when he says that Jesus did not come to condemn the world, but to save the world and to heal the world? What does it mean, even as we watch numbers of people, large numbers of people, continuing to be infected rapidly with the coronavirus? Even as we see more and more people dying every day? Even as we see countries with greater resources than ours becoming overwhelmed by the demands and threats that this disease is presenting to people? Yes, friends, the good news for us is that God's plan for the world is not to condemn the world, but to bring healing and wholeness to a world that is broken. God's promise through Jeremiah is this: "I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. Plans for your welfare and not to harm you, to give you a hope and the future." That is why Jesus came, and that is why he died. And that is why the prophet Isaiah could boldly declare that he was bruised for our transgression, he was crushed for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was laid upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. Jürgen Moltmann, in his book, The Crucified God, puts it this way: "God heals the sicknesses and the griefs by making the sicknesses and the griefs his suffering and his grief. In the image of the crucified God, the sick and the dying can see themselves, because in them the crucified God recognizes himself." Yes, friends, even as the fears continue to mount and we continue to wonder where is God in this time of crisis, we can take comfort in the fact that God is with us, taking on the pain of the world and offering healing to the brokenhearted and wholeness to the infirm. Indeed, brothers and sisters, God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that through him the world might be saved. Amen. Jesus promised, brothers and sisters.
Our hymn of response is number 170 in the Voices Empress, Love Lifted Me.
Dear Heavenly Father, I come before you this morning, not in any goodness of my own, but because of your love, your mercy, and compassion. And so, Lord, I pray that you would purify my heart and cleanse me from all unrighteousness as I endeavor to intercede on behalf of others, through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Lord, I bring the Church Universal before you. As we face the fear and anxiety that confronts us daily, Lord, may you pour out a double portion of your wisdom to all our ministers and our leaders as they attempt to keep the flock together. Lord, just give them the right word, word to uplift and calm the fear that is felt at this time. Father, your people of the world is troubled, and so I pray for leaders. Guide them, O God, to make the decision that would benefit all. Give them the strength, wisdom, and endurance that they need to chart the way forward economically amidst the pandemic. Father, I pray for your intervention in the lives of our doctors, nurses, health providers, and administrators as they struggle and sacrifice their life and well-being of their family to keep us safe. Lord, strengthen them. May they feel your presence ever close to them and the assurance that you are able to protect them. Father, look upon our children and young people in a special way. Lord, may you build a hedge of protection around them. Shield them, O God, from the snare of the enemy. And remind them, Lord, that you are always with them in good times and times of uncertainty. Father, I pray in this time of confinement that our families would draw closer to you and to each other. Those who may be separated, hurting, grieving the passing of loved ones, especially at this time when they are grieving alone, bind them together, Lord. May your peace enfold them. Comfort them at this time, Lord, and give them your grace to endure the sorrow and pain that they feel. Father, I pray for every sick person, especially those who are affected by COVID-19 at this time. May they feel your presence. Fill them with hope, with joy and peace, and the assurance that they need at this time. Lord, touch their bodies as only you can, and may they be constantly reminded that you are the great physicians by whose stripes we are healed. Father, we know that you are bigger than our problems. You're bigger than our fears. And as we face the unknown, remind us, Lord, that you are the God of yesterday, the God of today and forever. And you are able to take care of us. Father, may we as Christian, Lord, just draw closer to you. May we use this time as a time of introspection, examine our lives, and draw closer to you as a people. Guide us, dear Lord. In Jesus' name I pray with thanksgiving. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
We now bring this act of worship to a close by singing the hymn number 405 in the Voices in Praise, or 738 in the Methodist hymn book, Revive Thy Work, O Lord.
Thank you.
receive the benediction. And now may God the Father bless you, and may Jesus our brother comfort you, and may the Holy Spirit our comforter and guide continue to journey with you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless. Have a good day, one and all.